Money in the way for what they got to say. I throw it up, it's falling down, it's definitely in the way.
Welcome back, guys. Chart Talk, Chick and myself. We're going to be going through the market outlook, member ideas, good trade, bad trade, as well as top idea for the week. Shake, if you want to get started, give a little market outlook.
Let's get it started. All right. So last week, middle of the week, we got some good news, some bullish news. Fed cut interest rates 0.25. The second that happened, Trump got on Twitter to badmouth Fed Chair Jerome Powell. He's looking for a bigger rate cut. And then 2 days later, pretty much right at the close Friday, he ramps up the China trade war stuff, says he doesn't need a deal before the election, which we all know isn't very true. But he's got that you know, automatic bullish catalyst in his back pocket, so he's holding it, where if he does any deal with any sort of deal with China, the stock market's going to rip. So right now the stock's at highs. It makes sense that, you know, he's playing the game a little bit, and he's saying that he doesn't need the deal. So he said that last Friday. We got a little bit of a sell-off. But we got a nice pivot in the market today. We were holding up, so we'll see if today's low is a pivot that we, you know, have a nice little up move towards highs again, or if, you know, we take out today's low and kind of test that support a little bit lower. Right now, it remains to be seen. We're getting so much action and news different every day. I'm taking it day by day. It's sticking with the strongest names mostly. That's all I really got. I'm just taking it day by day. What do you think, Bennett?
I mean, I think it's the same thing. A lot of you reiterated. I know we spoke last week about like this SPY 302, the retest of highs. You know, we tend to see that most people want it to break through, but more often than not, that's usually not the case. So again, we'll see what happens with these rate cuts and with Trump tweeting. But still plenty of setups out there. We got a couple of really good chart ideas from the members this week. So if you want, we'll jump into E-Rich's. He's looking at FND through 50.
Yeah, I mean, there's not much to dislike about this chart. This FND is a thing of beauty. Bull flag, top right corner, absolutely so strong. High volume last couple of days. Through that 50, this thing should go.
Nice. We got Brian Trung, a bunch of people also looking. This is PFPT through one.
It's the most popular setup going around right now.
Yeah, I wonder who brought it up first.
Yeah, but like for a reason. This is a near A-plus setup. The only thing is they're making it a bit tricky with the super wide range price action up and down 5 points today. But once it can sustain a move through that 129, it triggers that big macro weekly chart trade. So that's what we're really looking at for that one. So I love this chart too. It was trade of the week last week and it's just been consolidating. So it's like I'm really waiting for this one to go.
Yeah, I'm with you with that one as well. We got Franklin Matson looking at WLTW through 200. Financial name.
Financial name, but it looks pretty good. I mean, upper level bull flag at highs, looks pretty strong, had a nice little tight inside date today. 4 or 5 weeks consolidation below the resistance level. Nothing really to dislike about that chart.
Yeah. Let's see. We got Nicholas, BSX through 43.5, 44.
This BSX is a tricky one. It's a really nice weekly chart. Definitely looks like it moves higher. But the problem is it just kind of ran up from support to resistance so quickly that I'm really hesitant to buy that 43.50, let's say tomorrow or this week. I just feel like there's a lot of tight setups out there. Even though it's a great macro level, I think it just needs like a week of consolidation. So if it gives us a week of consolidation, I'll be like chomping at the bits for the setup. But right now it's just tough to, because you really got to give it time for that 41, I guess, if you really want the trade. So that's what makes it tough for me to buy this one right now, but definitely watching it.
Yeah, this almost kind of reminds me of a name that Ryan asked me about today. He's looking at it. He's like, oh, I want to buy Voya above 55.5. And this is kind of the same thing where it's like, bigger picture, yeah, this 55 has been the spot, but like you're buying it $7 up off lows. Like you missed a big chunk of this move. Like you have to be perfect up here. It's like, this is just like big picture looks sick, but shorter term, it's like you're so late to the party. You're not walking into anything too profitable, at least in my opinion.
Yeah, but no, I definitely agree.
Let's see. Next up, we got Joe DeFrank, eBay. eBay 41.
Yeah, I like this chart. We've been watching this eBay just consolidate for literally 2 quarters. I was really excited about this one 2 quarters ago when it gapped up. And it gapped up to 39 2 quarters ago. And now we're looking at 41. It's just like been pretty much basing the entire time. So I'll do that 41. It definitely looks good. Yeah, hopefully we can get a decent up move out of this thing. It's just been going sideways for so long. It's almost due.
Yeah, I mean, if you zoom out, that the 41-42 definitely looks pretty good. Let's see. Next up, we got Sam is looking at HUBG through 47, which shakedown.
Yeah. Sorry for cough, sorry. I was just kidding today. it looks awesome. Macro, big picture chart, matching up with the daily chart. Really nice, tight daily flag in front of that 47, which is a big weekly chart level. These are like the best setups out there.
Yeah. It's funny. I think we have to start telling, making it like a rule that you can't send a shakedown trade.
No. I was just kidding. I like to play around.
And we got Tom is looking at something a little different. This ALGN 190.
Yeah, I saw that on the list, and I know exactly what I did. I mean, this is kind of more of your style of chart, and it's very similar to that WDC. And I know he just crushed that WDC trade along with you. It makes sense that he's looking for these extreme support buys. So this definitely is not a chart for me, not my time frame, but I see what he's looking at, and it could work out. Yeah, it's more of like your kind of time frame with the big picture. Yeah. I see the trade off the base. It's not something I'll take, but it makes sense to me.
Yeah, there was when we got to Goodyear Bachelor, I have like my two trades that were kind of similar to this ALGN, and again, both of them pretty much, well, at least one of them didn't really work, but I didn't really lose much, so we'll go into that a little later. Rounding up, we got Colson looking at this AMED, which was we talked about.
I bought a lot of this AMED today. You got to give it down to that 131 for at least like a piece of your core, but this is just like an insane level, this 137 area. I'm really looking for a push up in the next couple of days through 137, 138, and then it's got the huge level 140, 142. This is the best chart out right now to me.
Yeah, I have that buy up in 140. I'll be buying the highs with you guys.
Yeah.
And then last up, we got Carl. He has two. They're both worth mentioning. He has this JD through 32. Going back to our prop days.
Yeah. I know, JD. Stepper. This JD is very similar to that Momo that we traded last week. I'm going to highlight that in a good trade, bad trade, where it's just like it looks so good going into the level. And then once that bad news of China came out, all these names kind of sunk. So, I mean, I don't really like trading these names that become news dependent. Mm-hmm. Like all these China names are becoming news dependent. We saw Momo last week. I'll talk about it a little bit. But mm-hmm. if it gets up there and we get some good news or a trade war or something, then that 32 is like definitely a go. Right now, I just don't see it happening anytime soon.
All right. Your screen went black.
No, fucking Christ.
Yes. Yes, it did. We got Carl's other ideas is deer through 166, 167 area.
That deer is a really nice, huge macro level. Definitely looks good. So funny. Do you remember the last time deer had a huge level like this?
Uh-huh.
Oh, my God.
Actually, I bought it. It was July 19th. I bought it through and got stopped out break even. And, like, that thing got murdered. Uh-huh. It dropped 25 points after that break even stop.
I'm talking about back in the day. I'm talking about 95, back in the day.
Oh, hold on.
Back in the days, the firm days.
Oh, I don't remember.
So do you remember, it was so funny, when people used to get so excited about levels, like so insanely excited about levels. This deer, this is like a perfect example where it had this crazy 95 level and it flagged in front of it. And I was like, we were like a year and a half into trading, maybe like 2 years at this point. They're like, way too cocky about things. I was like calling all my friends, like, buy this fucking deer, 96, 97. Thing got destroyed, and all my friends fucking hated me afterwards.
Oh, okay. This is back. This is like mid 2015.
Yeah. So haven't traded much after that. I was kind of scarred. But no. This 166 is really nice. Nice daily consolidation. A few bucks below that 170 weekly level, So, you know, I love daily consolidation, a few dollars down before like a major resistance level. So you don't have to buy the resistance level, like AMED, for example. But this is exactly that. So I definitely think it looks good. You try something against that 162 and keep it tight. Yeah, I like that one. Just I'm not buying deer.
Okay, so you rounded up all numbers ideas. We can go into good trade, bad trade. If you want to.
Yeah, for sure. You start.
All right. So I had two. One was this BABA. Last week we were buying this 180, you know, and the only really thing that I was annoyed about myself is normally we had that sick first day where it, you know, gapped up above 180, ripped $4. When it was at 184, you know, we had guys who wanted to buy 184. Everyone thought it was going to 200. And we had to kind of check that. And it was like, you know, break even stop. We'll see what it does.
Right.
And the only thing I'm annoyed about is that I gave it like an extra dollar. So instead of it being break even 179.89, losing nothing, I gave it like a random $1. So I lost a dollar in the trade, which it should have just been a break even trade. So that's just more like it just pissed me off that I lost money when it should have really been just a break even trade. Okay. But I'll still buy 180 again. It probably is going to need some time now if they're just, you know, getting smoked down through it today. And then the second one was this Ulta, which was similar to Tom looking at that ALGN, which again, it's not top right. It's kind of that support buyback. And this was one where I bought to 230. The real out was, you know, 6 points lower versus those lows. But again, I know that I'm buying a name that's not really that strong. It got pretty beat up over earnings. So I'm not trying to give this name a ton of room. So after I got that first pop the first day, when I bought the 230, it rips like $5 or $6. I'm like, this is a break-even stop. It's this. I know this trade is more like a shot. It's not one that I'm going to, you know, catch perfectly and ride it back to 360. So it was just like I had going into it was $5 risk. Day one, it started to work. And I'm like, okay, break-even stop. It continues to go higher. Great. If not, I'm out. So this was kind of like this ALG, you know, this ALGN where if Tom does want to buy it, you got to, when you buy through 190, it's tough to give it 20 points versus the low. So then it's like, do you give it 10 points? You know, try to get that turn break-even stop. So those were kind of those, you know, the Ulta lesson was similar to this, what this ALGN can be. And then BABA is just kind of, you know, me being pissed off that I lost a dollar per share when it really should have been break-even. Yeah. Those the two main ones for the week. What about you?
I didn't have a ton going on last week. We're in this MoMA. This will be the bad trade. Now, the setup was there. Everything looked great. The one thing we did well with it was so we bought right over that pivot. I started buying like 35.75. I kept it pretty tight. We got a pop 237 on the second day. And the one thing we did well with it, I was talking to Heaven and T-Fresh, especially with it, where we got it right up the open. It looked like it was going to like rage through 37. We're like, oh, this thing's hitting 38, 39. Everyone's so excited. And then a few ticks, it immediately ticks down like 50, 60 cents. And so quickly, like everyone goes quiet in the chat. You know, you can hear a pin drop, you know, metaphorically, if you will. And then we get, because 60 cents of a $30 name, you're feeling that if you have any size. So then we get another pop, like 50 cents back to highs. And we're all like, oh, sold some, took a third off. So at least we paid for the trade. But as soon as that China trade war stuff came out, late Friday, this thing got sold so hard. So pretty much break even, maybe a little red on the trade. Nothing special there. And then the good trade was, it was today actually. It was only, I was getting light, this FTNT. So I highlighted this in the shakedown. It's at a huge inflection point. And the way it closed Friday below the moving averages, the hammer looking to the downside, I was actually looking to get short this thing. But I knew it was at an inflection point, so I was being flexible. I wasn't rigid in my theory or my trade hypothesis. I was kind of going to let the price action dictate. That's the one thing I did really well. So I was watching. I was watching that 78 super support run off the open today. And I saw sellers try to hit the bid really hard. And the buyers were just very present. And it just exploded upwards off the open. So I bought a little bit around 79 just against that 78. And I think it looks really good for an add through 80 tomorrow. Even if you're not in the trade, I think it's good to buy through 80 tomorrow. It's such a tight inflection point. So I set myself up for really well. The thing I did well was being flexible. It was like, all right, I see the buyers there at major support, take this thing long on tight risk. And, you know, now I have a really good opportunity tomorrow to add some heavy size through that 80.
Nice. I like that.
Yeah.
I remember seeing that with you. I hate to be the damper, but your camera went black again.
Shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
All right. So, Nothing ever happens. What are we talking about?
I think we're on a book of the week.
Oh god, I think we're the worst fucking YouTubers in history.
Oh, we never did the thumbs up.
Thumbs up.
You're still with us after two blackouts.
Oh yeah.
So we got Think and Grow Rich.
Oh wait, no, we didn't do what we like. Sorry. Oh. That's top ideas. Get them in quick while my camera's working.
Okay. Top ideas. I got Nike.
So they just had earnings, right?
They have earnings.
I think they had earnings after the close. They're gapping up. I saw Heaven say Nike opening range break candidate.
Yeah, so I have an 89 buy stop, and then 90 is like that, you know, all time high break.
So if that's triggering on earnings, that could be a little feasty.
Yeah, so that's a good one. And then there's PCAR.
Every week we talk about this stuff. Yeah.
But 70,
one of these weeks.
72, 73. Eventually, this thing's got to go.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Those are the good ones.
Chicka, what do I like? So we mentioned PFPT. We all like that. We mentioned AMED. We all like that. This GOSS, G-O-S-S, this recent IPO. When this finally clears the 2250, 2260 sellers, I really think this is going to explode. I bought it heavy today when it broke. And I kind of lightened up when it didn't, when I saw it kind of faded the level. I downticked a lot of my stock. So I have my core right now, so I can give it room. But if I see volume come through over that 2250, 2260 area, I really like that one. And then this RCII is so tight. I bought a little feeler today through that like 26 like quarter area. It's just such a tight risk top right chart. Worth my risk every time.
Yeah, this is like a bread and butter. It's like a super tight wedge.
Super, yeah, exactly.
Favorite chart.
Yes.
All right. So I think we can jump in a good.
let's fucking get out of here before the camera blacks out again.
I got Think and Grow Rich, classic book by Napoleon Hill. Two of the, you know, a lot of pages I've done this book, a lot of good stuff, but a couple of keynotes. One was anything acquired without effort and cost is generally unappreciated, often discredited, which we see all the time. And then they have one chapter on like 30 reasons people fail. And two of the big ones, especially the trading, was guessing instead of thinking, and then lack of capital, and then gambling with the lack of capital, which we see all day long with people. Like I saw someone this week buy a $1 call option on a $1 penny stock.
My God.
So he's renting the shares for like a week expiration. Could have bought, like, for the same $100 that he bought the call for, he could have bought the 100 shares. Like that's the level of dumb that there is out in the market. So that was the main thing I learned from this book, but highly recommend. Classic book.
You know, I've never read that book. I got to read that one.
It's an old one.
Yeah, it's like one of the most classic like wealth creation and mindset books out there. My turn. I got The Upstarts by Brad Stone. It's a story about Uber and Airbnb, how they were huge disruptors. It came out like 2014, 2015. It's just the kind of the story of Uber, Airbnb. Mostly, it's the story of Travis Kalanick and Brian Chesky, the CEOs, and the drastic measures and kind of mindset, and you know how they had to be these major disruptors. And when in doing so, in becoming a major disruptor, you're going to face a lot of backlash. And it was great to read about the tribulations that these companies really faced on their way up. Absolutely great read. It's a good story, so you can get through it really quickly. Highly recommend The Upstarts.
Nice. All right, guys, if you've been through all the technical difficulties, fuck us. Drop us a thumbs up.
Yeah, drop that.
See you in the chat. See you on Instagram. Have a good
one.